Good morning, colleagues, and welcome to the fifth meeting of the 2016 of the Finance Committee. As usual, can I remind members to switch off their mobile phone and at least put them into a mode that won't interfere with today's business. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take item 3 in private, and members agreed. Agreed, thank you. The next item on our agenda is to take evidence on the Fraser of Allender Institute Scotland's Budget 2016 report from Professor Graeme Roy. Members have received copies of the report which considers the outlook for the Scottish economy. Having read the report cover to cover, I can see it's a significant challenge that we have ahead of us, not just the Scottish Government, but obviously the Scottish Parliament. And I welcome Professor Graeme Roy to our meeting, and I invite Professor, do you want to make an opening statement?
I can do, yeah. Thanks so much for the invitation to come along today and talk about a report we published last week. Perhaps if I just give you some context about what we're doing in the Fraser Islander, because I think that might be quite useful for your thinking going forward. But we've done quite a lot of investment over the summer to expand our capacity in fiscal analysis and economic analysis, and we've actually been able to get some really talented young people in to look at this. And I think that's really exciting for Scotland, that actually we're able to now have a much better analysis of issues like this, the economic challenges and the fiscal challenges for Scotland going forward. And I think that's really, really encouraging. And this report is essentially our first foray into that landscape. And what we do in it really is essentially look at what type of scenarios might the Scottish budget face over the course of the next Parliament, given what we know at the moment about the plans that the previous Chancellor had for departmental spending, what we might think might happen in the autumn statement if the new Chancellor chooses to reset fiscal policy and what that may look like. But then also we know that as of next year in particular, substantial new tax powers start to kick in and the outlook for Scotland's economy and these revenues start to have an increasing impact on the Scottish budget. So essentially what we do is we try and pull all that together to give some scenarios and a flavour of what the Scottish budget might look like up to the end of the Parliament, the challenges and the opportunities that come in there. And then the second part we do is we look at what are the big commitments that the Scottish Government have already committed to, trace them through, look at how much that will commit the Scottish budget over the next few years, and then essentially ask the question, well, what does that mean for everything else? And therefore, what are the opportunities and what are the challenges and what are the risks in that as well? And then finally, at the end, we kind of indulge in what we think should be the kind of key priorities and issues that should focus the debate in what we believe to be quite a challenging environment over the next few years. So we talk about issues around transparency and scrutiny and the focus on outcomes. And that's really essentially us setting out what we think should be the key themes for the discussion over the next few months as the government and parliament look to set its budget.
Thank you, Professor. Obviously, your report outlines a number of scenarios for Scotland's budget over the coming years, and many of which are challenging, to say the least. I'd like to ask you a couple of questions myself today, one concerned with the short term, the other with the longer term issues about structural challenges. But firstly, in regard to the financial year 2017-18, I'd be grateful if you could lay out for us the potential budget reduction scenarios for the Scottish budget that are likely to result from the Chancellor's autumn statement. And if you could let us have your views on how challenging these reductions will be, both for the Scottish Government and for the Scottish Parliament, that I would be most grateful.
Okay, so for into 2016-2017, and then, so using that as a baseline, and into 2017-2018, prior to Brexit, so before the talk about fiscal reset, the Scottish budget was forecast to fall around about 100 million between these 2 years on the fiscal resource deal. So I guess that's quite a useful starting point. So the budget was going to fall from this year into next year anyway. And what we then do is we say, okay, well, what could fiscal reset look like? So one scenario is where the Chancellor decides to stimulate public spending and boost departmental public expenditure. So we think, as an approximation, as a rough outline, then that could add an extra 100 million on to the Scottish budget into next year. But on balance, I think our feeling is that if the Chancellor is going to stimulate fiscal policy in the autumn statement, it's more likely to focus on things like tax cuts or capital investment, because they're the things that are more likely to have an immediate positive impact on the economy. So if you're worried about economic uncertainty, then boosting consumer spending, boosting household incomes tends to typically have a more immediate impact than increasing departmental expenditure. So that's one scenario. The scenario where, which probably is the bleakest outlook for the Scottish budget, would be as a situation where if the Chancellor decides that he is or believes that he's going to miss his fiscal targets, or at least the intention to try and get the deficit down over the next few years, he may decide to take further money out of departmental spending in the short term. So we have a scenario in there where we assume that if he wants to take an extra £9 billion out over the next 4 years, what would that look like for the Scottish budget? And that would mean that next year it would be an additional £200 million reduction in Scotland's budget over on top of the £100 million reduction that we have at the moment. So you're talking about, you know, an additional reduction of £200-300 million over the course of next year.
Yeah, and in that regard, how challenging would if it was out at that margin at 300 million from your own scenarios, how challenging would that be for the Scottish Government?
Well, I guess there's two things. One is, I guess, is to put that into context. So one view of that would be is to look at the budget in the entirety and to actually say, well, if you look at the entire, you know, £26 billion worth of expenditure, magnitude of 200 million, 300 million coming out is not that significant. So that's one view. I guess the other alternative view in that is to look at actually what's the discretionary element that you have within the budget. So we know that a large proportion of the budget is largely already determined by wages, by, you know, spending commitments already. So cuts of, you know, 200 or 300 million pounds between this year and next year is actually quite significant, and it would actually be quite a challenge to take out.
Okay, and what measures do you think the Scottish Government might be able to take to deal with that sort of challenge?
Well, I mean, I guess there's a number of different things that government could do in response. There's obviously a question which will probably be revealed at the autumn statement, in that, is this a temporary reaction, and is it just the chance of going to change the profile of spending? So will public spending increase towards the end of the parliament? So there may be opportunities for the government to reprofile spending depending on what happens in the autumn statement. There's obviously tough choices that will have to be made around prioritisation of expenditure programmes, and then there's obviously now the new tax powers that the Scottish Government have, and the government may choose to utilise these to try and make up some of the difference, or they may choose to prioritise expenditures in other areas. But it would be a challenging situation.
Okay, well, I think that explores well in a general sense the sort of conditions for next financial year. Neil Bibby.
You just talk about prioritisation of spending, and obviously we've heard from the Scottish Government that's in your report about their commitment to increase health spending, maintain police expenditure, expand childcare, and also a commitment to other policies such as free tuition and other things. As things stand at the moment, can these be delivered without having cuts in other areas of spending? And what is the largest budget outside these priority areas where we could see cuts?
So when you have a tight fiscal settlement, and what we show in the report is that that's likely to be the case, then it necessarily follows that if you choose to prioritise some areas of expenditure and increase it, then that has consequences, and that means that other areas in the budget will have to take up the slack and have to be cut to compensate for that. So even if the budget was to be flat in real terms over the next few years, if you choose to prioritise spending and increase it in some areas, then that necessarily means that other areas have to fall back. So I guess the point I would just make to be clear about that, and what we say in our report, is just to also be clear that if you are going to criticise or have concerns about cuts in other areas, then it necessarily follows that you you can't make these commitments to increase. So it's essentially, it's a zero-sum game that if you're going to take away from one hand, then you obviously have to add back in the other. So what we do is look at that. So obviously health, childcare and police are really quite big commitments. So essentially what we do in the report is look at what's left. We have these unprotected areas. And by far the largest area that's in that unprotected area is the local government settlement. So around about the 6.8 billion. So we're rough approximation. You're looking at a resource budget, say 26 billion, 14 billion of that will largely be protected. So the remaining kind of 8 billion that's left there, out of that, the largest element is the local government settlement.
You mentioned unprotected areas, local government being the biggest. Are there any other services? You know, you've talked about the cuts that there have been to local government and could continue to be. Are there any other areas within that has under the direct responsibility of the Scottish Parliament has seen the same level of cuts as the local government budget?
Well, we've not looked at individual spending lines going back, and that's one of the challenges I think with the way that the budget document and the way the budget material is presented, that actually to do time series profiles over a large number of years is quite challenging to do. Even within the local government, you know, figure, you have monies coming in and coming out, so police and fire coming out of the local government budget. In the past, there's obviously the debate about the 250 million health and social care money, is that in local government or outside it? So I think what we've done really here is just try and look at local government on a like-for-like basis over the next few years and look at the challenge that they've had. We also document and talk about some areas which have been cut, you know, in other areas, whether local government has been cut by more or less. I've not looked at explicitly, but it's something that could be done.
Finally, you've talked there about opportunity costs and in the report about for the need for greater recognition of the opportunity costs of spending decisions. That would indicate that there is already a degree of recognition of opportunity costs within the budget process. Could you give us an example of currently where the Scottish Government weighs up the opportunity costs of its spending decision?
Well, I mean, I guess the principle really of opportunity costs is back to, I guess, the original point I was making, that particularly when you have a tight budget settlement, if you choose to spend money in one particular area or increase expenditure in one particular area, then the implication of that is that you have to cut back in somewhere else. So a commitment to substantially increase and invest in health, what we would argue is that you need to look at that and you need to recognise that. And it's, you know, if that's a positive commitment and that's something that is seen as being beneficial, then that's fine. But the opportunity cost of that is that in a tight fiscal settlement, other budgets have to take up the slack. So I think what we would say that when you're looking at spending commitments and when we're making them, you need to think about what the consequences are on the other side. And that could either be through increased taxation for it, which is an opportunity cost, or it could be savings in other budgets to pay for that.
Willie, Coffey.
Professor Roy, you say in your report on page 30 that the previous Chancellor's plans to achieve a surplus by 2019-20 has been abandoned. I take it from that then that what we're expecting is a lengthening of the austerity programme, pushing it further into the future, and your figures just below that, if I could just get this correct in my head, between 2016, 17 and 2021, the Scottish budget could fall between anything between 2.8 and 6.2%. And the equivalent figures for that are something between 700 million and 1.6 billion. Can you just clarify, is that that's every year on year in that five-year term, the worst case scenario could be a £300 million cut to the Scottish budget?
Yeah, so I mean, just picking up on the first point about what we mean about reset and the fact that he's abandoned his target of getting a surplus by 1920. There's quite a lot in that about what that means. So if you believe that the economy is now going to be slower, to grow more slowly over the next few years, then that means that borrowing will be higher than it otherwise would have been. So fiscal reset and abandoning the fiscal surplus target could actually happen, and it probably has actually happened, without any discretionary choice by the Chancellor, because he's likely to now miss the target of having a fiscal surplus by 1920, just because tax revenues are going to be lower or welfare expenditure is going to be higher because of a slowing economy post the EU referendum. So the plan to abandon the target can mean a lot of things. It could just mean that. So then there's no other changes in tax policy, welfare policy, or departmental spending policy from that. What that could mean on a more interventionist approach, so could that mean that it could be abandoned because, in addition to that, he's going to cut taxation or increase public expenditure, then that could be one scenario. It could also be entirely conceivable that they might still choose to abandon the fiscal surplus target by 1920, but still make up some of the difference. So if borrowing is now going to be slightly higher than they thought it was, then they could still actually make additional cuts to try and get down. So that's why we get this range of scenarios that we have there. The numbers you're talking about between 2016-17 and 2021, the falls in the 2.8 and 6.2, that's essentially the full fall from 16-17 to 2021. So that's the entire fall. So the 6.2% fall over the period. So that works in about 1.6% fall year on year in the worst case scenario. And in the best case scenario, it's a fall of just under 1%. So, and again, as an approximation, you know, you're looking at the budget was due to fall next year by 100 million. The scenario we do where they do an additional consolidation adds an extra 200 million on top of that. The one thing I would say about these things is that they are really scenarios to illustrate the scale of the challenge. You know, we don't yet know exactly what will happen until the autumn statement kicks in. And there's a whole feast of different things happening in here, outlook for the economy, inflation here as well. That's one of the things which we know is a risk, but we don't actually include it explicitly in this forecast. But it's entirely conceivable that if the Bank of England continue to set an expansionary monetary policy, which is generally perceived to be a good thing given the uncertainty at the moment, that one of the consequences of that is slightly higher inflation, at least in the short term. That then means that the real terms pressure on the Scottish budget is increased. It also means that some of the commitments that are made in real terms become more costly. So if you're protecting the police budget in real terms and inflation is higher, then it necessarily means that you have to put more cash into the police budget, and that will obviously then have consequences elsewhere.
Yeah, thank you for that explanation. But when you consider that the budget's been under pressure really and suffering cuts since about 2010, and to look to another period of this austerity, and picking up on the point my colleague Neil Bibby mentioned there about the pressure on services, there's a feeling, of course, Convener, that services are already under pressure and cut to the bone and can suffer no more. Do you get the sense that there's a real risk to existing policies that the Scottish Government actually has in place, that there's a risk that some of those may not be able to be funded and afforded in over this five-year period that we're in?
I mean, I think that kind of starts to stray into political choices and political commitments, which essentially I don't think our report really aims to do that, other than what we're trying to do is just set out the numbers and set out the scale of the challenge. And ultimately, I think what we would say is it always comes down to choices. So it comes down to essentially what's the pot of money that you have to spend, what are the priorities that you want to spend that money on, and increasingly now with the new fiscal powers for Scotland, do you want to try and raise additional money to help pay for them? But again, the point about that Neil Bibby was talking about opportunity costs, that comes with an opportunity cost. So if you want to try and invest in public services and potentially counter the fact that the block grant is being cut, yes, one option is to increase taxation. That's clearly one thing you can do. So you can add a penny onto income tax and raise 400 million as a simple illustration. But that has consequences. It has consequences for economic activity, potentially. It has consequences for how services are delivered. So I think there's a whole variety of different things in there. I don't think whether or not these commitments are under pressure, etc., I think is something which we don't necessarily touch on in this report. All we're really doing here is just setting out the scenarios and the facts of the numbers.
Is it possible to say whether, even with the fiscal powers that are coming to us, that in exercising them, are they sufficient to even address the scale of the deficit, the scale of the cuts that we could be facing? Is it possible to do that? Or did you have a look at that?
I guess within that, again, you know, I think that essentially comes back to a political choice about what's your priorities of taxation versus expenditure. So if you're talking about, say, for example, a cut of £300 million, you know, within 1 year, or £200 million within 1 year, the Scottish Parliament now has the powers to address that. So, as I said, you know, as an approximation, a penny in income tax would raise, you know, £300-400 million. So you could do that, but that has that has consequences, and there are, you know, opportunity costs within all of that. So the Parliament now has powers to do things. Whether it's the best use of these powers, I guess, again, is really a political question, a choice to be made.
Thank you.
Yeah, I've got Patrick Harvey and both Murdo Fraser have both said they want to ask supplementaries in this area. Patrick.
Well, thank you, Convener. Good morning. It was really on some of the issues that came up in the last minute or two about tax flexibility, and it was just to ask whether the report here places too much emphasis on the sort of rigid nature of current tax policy commitments. They're taken from the SNP manifesto, and it seems to me that a reading of the report suggests that there's an assumption that they are now government policy. Regardless of which party is in power, don't we need to move away from that kind of assumption that manifesto commitments on tax policy are assumptions for the rest of a parliament, and move toward all of us an acceptance that whichever party is in government will be making these decisions on an annual basis given current circumstances?
Yeah, I mean, and that's a very good point. And I would just be clear about what we're doing in this report. So what we're doing in this report is really just saying what have Scottish Government said, you know, either in the Programme for Government or in the SNP manifesto. And we make quite clear that we're being transparent in saying that we take SNP manifesto commitments as being commitments that will now be at least presented by the Scottish Government to the Parliament to do it. So therefore, that means that there's then a consistency between what we're saying on the spending side, so a commitment to double childcare or to increase health expenditure, but then also the same commitments on air passenger duty to half the revenue of that, or sorry, to half what they would call the burden of air passenger duty going forward, or commitments on council tax, etc. But I think the point you make is entirely right, that actually now you need to think about the flexibility of taxation policy more generally, you know, not just in the spending side of things, and not just about things like opportunity cost, but actually what is your overall approach to taxation, and what's your strategic approach to raising revenue and balancing revenue? And in the final chapter of the report, we tease out some of these issues. We talk about how you might want to look at setting tax systems that are slightly more efficient. You might want to think about, you know, individual tax policies that might raise different amounts of revenue. But fundamentally, that comes back to a question about what is your overall approach to tax and spending within Scotland. And that now is, you know, is something which the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament now have much greater flexibility over. It's not just about 1 pence or 2 pence on income tax. You know, it's about, well, what is our overall approach to land and property tax? You know, what do we want to do around that? How can we make a system more efficient? And that, I guess, is a challenge in our report back to the policymakers to say, well, now you can actually look at that in a completely different way. So I take your point.
Thank you. If we're coming on to the preventative issues,
yeah, we're going to come back to that. I'm going to add and begin that sort of discussion when we get to that section. Murdo.
Thank you. It was really just a follow-up to the questions that Mr. Coffey was asking about the overall size of the budget. There's a comment in the report about how the Scottish Government has unprecedented autonomy in relation to the size of its budget and its budget choices. And there's a theme that runs through the report about how in future, increasingly it will be the performance of the Scottish economy and the tax revenues generated from the Scottish economy that will determine the overall size of the budget. And there's quite a striking table, you've got 2.4 on page 43, that shows you know, the potential differential in the size of the budget dependent upon growth in Scottish tax revenues. Have you looked at what level of economic growth would be required in Scotland to avoid the need for tax budget cuts in the future?
I guess there's two points to that. I would say, firstly, you're entirely right that actually now, crucially going forward, like it or not, the way the fiscal framework is set up, in that what really matters is Scotland's relative tax per head performance compared to the rest of the UK, means that how well Scotland does on that measure becomes crucial for the overall outlook for the Scottish budget. Because what will be growing the block grant adjustment, so the bit that will be taken out of the block grant every year, will be the equivalent UK tax receipt growth. So that is that's almost like a burden that will always be there going forward in the Scottish budget. So crucially is how much can you add back in by growing more quickly. And you can see that actually with the tax powers coming down the line and nearly half of the budget going to be determined by revenues raised in Scotland, very small changes in that relationship can actually feed through to quite significant changes in the Scottish budget over a very short period of time. So the example you're there in 2.4, the table there, is essentially where we just have a differential about 0.2 percentage points between Scotland and the rest of the UK. And you see after essentially 4 years, you're up to about 130 million either side additional revenues. So it becomes really crucial. And as you go forward over an even longer time period, then the growth performance of the Scottish economy becomes really fundamental to the overall outlook for the Scottish budget. I'd caution that to say that in the short term, what really matters is what happens to the block grant, because these effects take time to materialise. It's compounding every year and year. So in the immediate term, whether Scotland's budget goes up or down is not likely to be determined on a year basis simply by how our growth performance is. So it's not likely to be the dominant factor in any one year, but over a number of years, it will become absolutely crucial.
Yeah, and just one brief follow-up to that, if I may. In terms of your forecast, you seem to suggest that your forecast of the Scottish economy are not particularly optimistic in relation to the UK as a whole. Is that fair?
Yeah, so what we say in the short term, our kind of key conclusions really is that the Scottish economy has been fragile over the last 18 months. So if you look at our growth performance relative to the UK, we're growing at round about 0.6% over the last year. The UK has been growing closer to 2%. So and that's largely been driven by what's been happening in the North Sea. So I guess our assessment is that over the immediate term, do we see a dramatic change in that, given the headwinds that are still there in the North Sea as it's adjusting to its new normal? Then that is quite a challenging situation to have. And then if you look at the labour market as well, so we've had quite a sharp fall in unemployment over the last quarter. But if you actually look over the last year, employment has essentially been flat in Scotland, but growing in the UK. So taking that all together, we would say that when you add in Brexit, which will be a challenge for the UK as a whole, Scotland has that additional element in there as well of what's been happening over the last year. And that, in our view, means it'll be quite a challenging economic environment as these powers gradually kick in. But you will get back to a new normal, a new sustainability, and in the long run, the key is how Scotland does relative to the UK.
Obviously, got a couple of themes going here, both in terms of the overall impact of what the UK government does in terms of the budget level, then down into the issues of what we do with taxation, etc., and block grant adjustment. But to get the overall picture at the high level first, can I bring in Marie, and then I'm going to come to James Kelly on the issue of the taxation take and block grant adjustment issues.
Hi there. I think if I understand correctly what's happening in this decade between 2010 and 2020 is a 10% cut in real terms to the budget, which, as I understand it, is a result of a political choice, as you said, of the UK government to pursue an austerity agenda. Yeah? Well, you said that governments have a choice in how they deal with the situation that they're in, and the choice that the UK government has made was to cut spending, yes?
I'll come back on that.
But, okay, yeah. I'm possibly misunderstanding. What I wondered was the Scottish government obviously has a good track record. We've got, I know that the outlook, there are some challenges there, but I think fundamentally there are some strong points to our economy. And the Scottish government's got a really good track record of responding to these cuts. So I want you to talk a little bit more about how the cut to the block grant is impacting on the Scottish economy and what sort of response we might take to it.
Okay. I guess, the general point about the choice to cut public expenditure since 2010. And I think that there's obviously two parts to that. There's the political choice about the relative balance of cuts, the scale, the pace, etc. And that ultimately, to an extent, is a political choice. And people have different views on that, about the pace of consolidation, the relative balance, welfare versus tax versus expenditure. And that is ultimately a political choice. But but it's important to also remember that we were in a situation where a UK fiscal position was completely unsustainable back in the financial crisis. So adjustment had to happen. There's then a political choice about how you make that adjustment, and I accept that. From an economic perspective, it's simply not possible to run deficits of 10, 15% of GDP on a sustainable basis. Debt at the moment is still 80% of GDP. That's high in historic standards of over the last 50 years. There's obviously been higher. There have been times when debt has been a lot higher in the aftermath of Second World War and things like that. But ultimately, you have to get your fiscal position on a sustainable basis. How you do that, the relative balance of that, is ultimately a political choice. So I think that most people would accept that there had to be some degree of consolidation, over the last few years. There's then a debate and a view, which I'm sure you'll have, about whether that was too big, too small, or whatever. And we wouldn't really have a view on that. I think. But one of the consequences of that is that you do see the Scottish budget, shrinking in real terms over the next few years. And to put that in context, you're talking about the Scottish budget going back to levels about 2005, 2006. So again, that's quite useful to put it in context. That yes, it's a substantial cut over these few years, but it's still back at where we were back in, say, 10, 12 years ago. So, but that means that whether you've got against that, when you've got higher demand for public services, then that puts pressure on choices and how you do that. And what we do in the final part of the report is, I think, start to touch on this as you're talking about. Well, how do you actually, in a world where resources are much more constrained, how do you actually ensure that you still deliver public services that people want? And our point that we make here is really to start to the importance of focusing on outcomes and really focusing on prevention, really focusing on actually what matters. So rather than commitments that are particular numbers of people in a particular post or expended or portfolio lines being protected or increased, that what actually matters to people, how can we make people healthier? So how can we make people healthier so they're not accessing health services before we get to the point where we're then having to correct and invest all of that. So I think in a tight fiscal settlement, when you've got increasing demand for public services that are going to grow naturally as demographic change kicks in, then what can you do to reform and to be more ambitious about how you deliver outcomes and efficiencies?
I think that's...
Okay, the points about the difference in terms of tax take and how the block grant adjustment deals with that have already been taken up with Murdo Fraser. Just to kind of round off this kind of taxation part of it, though, you've mentioned a couple of times that a 1p tax rise, would equate to potentially adding £400 million onto the budget. And you outline in the document the SNP proposal stroke approach And you say that that would have a marginal impact on the budget. What kind of financial value would that potentially be?
So I think when we, in our report, we add up the commitments that the Scottish Government have made around tax, and you have essentially two sets of these. You have commitments that are going to increase revenue, so that's changes to the thresholds of income tax, you know, primarily. And the way the block grant adjustment works, that has essentially two effects. Firstly, by increasing the income tax threshold more slowly, then that actually will raise revenue in Scotland. But if at the same time the UK government are going to increase the threshold even more quickly, then that actually will reduce the block grant adjustment. So you get a double win in that. And so you get a tax increase there. But what we also do is we also note that the government have also commitments to cut taxation, the principal one being air passenger duty, so it's to half the burden in air passenger duty over the by the end of the parliament. So taking these two elements together, we estimate based on our modelling that that works out around about £213 million of additional increase in revenue by 2021. So that works out just under 1% of the overall Scottish budget by that period in time. So there's an additional increase to the Scottish budget from the discretionary tax policies of around about £213 million.
And just to be clear, is that £213 million per year or over the lifetime of the Parliament to 2020?
By the end. So by the time you get to 2021, what's the additional increase you've got? So it's the £200 million is there. So it's...
That's a cumulative position.
Well, no, it's the end position in that year. So it's how much higher in that year is tax revenues. So the cumulative would be that plus... the additional revenue you make
so that's
up in
the final,
additional years.
Okay,
exactly.
That's the final
it's the
year
final
position.
Year. It's the final year figure.
Right. Okay. And just one kind of final point, convener. The scenario that you're painting is that of a contracting Scottish budget due to a number of factors, a situation where we've got more taxation powers now at our disposal, but, you know, quite a stark situation for the government and all the parties to face up to. And you point to, you know, there needs some more discussion around outcomes. Do you think the debate needs a more open and honest exchange of views, you know, politicians and political parties, and I hold my hand up to this, tend to get, you know, stuck in our own positions and arguing fixed views. Do you think because of the scenario that you're painting, it needs a better quality and a more open debate about the issues to try and address, you know, to give a proper address to the problems that are outlined.
Yeah, and I think that's what we, I guess our kind of key conclusion, our key kind of recommendation from this report, and it kind of gets through all the stuff that we have in chapter 4 of the report, and to say that actually, you know, if you start from a position where you have a relatively fragile Scottish economy, a tight fiscal settlement, and increasing demand for public services, what's the solution to that? And the solution has to be an open discussion, an honest discussion about outcomes, about opportunity costs of policy decisions. And then also, what's the balance of tax and spend you want to have in the country, and be quite upfront and frank about that. And that starts to get into the point Patrick Harvey made about commitments in taxation. What more radical things could you look at in taxation? What's the overall structure of taxation that you want to have? And I think the more that we can get the debate onto that sort of thing, then the more I think you'll end up with a constructive outcome in what is likely to be a quite a challenging situation.
Exactly where Adam Tompkins wanted to take us in his questions.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, indeed, I wanted to move into Chapter 4, and in particular what you have to say there about opportunities looking forward. And one of the things that you say is that there are opportunities with regard to social security spending. I'm on page 77. Opportunities in particular, for example, to link up better responsibilities in health, education, skills, and so on and so forth. And my question really is, what role do you think the Finance Committee in particular can and should be playing in scrutinising how such opportunities are taken?
I mean, it's a good point. If I just made a general comment about the Social Security element, I mean, I think that's a really good example of where there is an opportunity to look at outcomes in a completely different way. So how do we focus on what is best for an individual? And then if you look at an individual, what's the best outcome that they can get? And therefore, what's the full spectrum of opportunities, intervention that the Scottish Government, local government, service providers, etc., can do for some, you know, for an individual? So that could be through the education, skills, social security system. So how can you get an overall package? And I think that's one of the key opportunities within the new powers that are coming to Scotland. How can you actually deliver them more efficiently, and how can you actually deliver things in a new way? I think the role of the Finance Committee in that is really to look at, well, again, you know, are we spending the money in the right way on an individual in terms of their outcome? So are we spending it once? Are we spending it most efficiently? And what gets the biggest bang for the buck that we've got in a world where we know we have tight resources? So I think looking at that, so taking examples of, you know, the new Social Security powers that are coming in and saying, well, actually, what are we doing with this, and how is this complementing the existing interventions that we have for individuals in a way which delivers positive outcomes?
Thank you. So that leads me into a second question, which I think, you know, relates directly to what you've just said, which is that on a couple of occasions in this chapter of the report, you talk about the importance of effective parliamentary scrutiny of draft budget plans. You say that the importance of effective fiscal scrutiny is more crucial than ever, given the environment that we're in. And you say, and again, I'm quoting, that it's vital to protect the Parliament's role in budgetary scrutiny. Now, as you probably know, the Scottish Government is proposing significantly reduced time for budget scrutiny in this session, as it did, I think, in the last session. I just wondered if you had any reflections on that in the light of what you've just said about the importance of effective and robust parliamentary scrutiny.
Yeah, so I mean, I fully stand by the statement that we need really robust scrutiny and examination of these issues, and I think that's really crucial. I guess the issue is, which I guess you're all wrestling with, and the government will be wrestling with as well, is you know, how do you best do that scrutiny in a world which is now, you've now got much greater tax powers, and it now is much more complex in how we interact with UK fiscal policy through the autumn statement and block grant adjustments and things like that. And do we come before or after the autumn statement? And I know that that's a challenge, that if you go after the autumn statement and you really condense the scrutiny period that Parliament has. I think the one thing I would say about that, and we start to touch on the report, is that probably make a distinction between the length of time you have to scrutinise something and the quality of the scrutiny that can come in. I think there's an issue in there about what more information can be provided by the government to allow really effective scrutiny over potentially a shorter period of time. But even if that doesn't happen, how much more information could you provide? And one of the big advantages, if you actually look at the OBR, what they've done is they've really transformed how people view budget documents at a UK level. Of course, you know, you can criticise the OBR, like you can criticise us for getting forecasts wrong and things like that. But the level of information they provide now means that anyone can go and know exactly how they've come up with the various forecasts and the various, you know, the various elements. And we don't have that yet. And I would say that that's the sort of thing that would be really useful to have, to have much more information around that. Issues around presentation of the material within budgets. So you have the issue, which is a common complaint and a challenge that we had about, where you have some budgets presented with depreciation in it, some budgets without depreciation in it. So you actually find it hard to go from one part of the budget document to another part of the budget document. So how can you actually provide much more information to capture that? How can you look at data that has, for example, splits between what is already committed and what's not? We know, for example, that there are large commitments in certain budgets around NPD, PPP, around wages, etc., etc. So actually having much more information on that, I think, will let you scrutinise, you know, what choices the government have within these individual spending lines. So I think there's quite a lot you could do to improve the quality of scrutiny that's available, and that might be the sort of thing that I would say that, you know, this new budget review group could actually really look at. What type of information and what quality of information would enable you to scrutinise the budget in a much more effective way, even if the time period is relatively short?
That's extremely helpful. Thank you very much.
Ivan McKee.
Yeah, I wanted to drill down more into this this outcomes thing. I've also got a brief supplementary on some of the stuff Murdo brought up. If we've got time, I can squeeze it in at the end if that's
okay. We'll see
what we get to. So it's firstly on the outcome stuff and round about the section 4.2, and you're talking about, which is obvious. You talk about the way spending is done at the moment by big departments and everybody's fighting for their, based on historically what they've had, et cetera, and how you shift, culturally shift that to something where you're focused on outcomes, talking about the national performance framework, how you link the budget lines up to that. So conceptually it all makes sense, but you're talking about the quality of scrutiny as well, and that all ties together. How do we get from where we are to where we need to be? And I'm just looking at your report, which is 92 pages, and you've got two pages on that. You say it's really, really important and we need to do a lot of work on it and we need to not just give it lip service and then you do two pages on it and move on to something else. So I suppose, A, are you planning to do more work on this? B, what should we do as a committee? And most of us are new to this, so we're just kind of, we're open to doing it differently from how it's been done before. And then what might the scope of that be? I mean, Christy talks about 40%. In my experience from the business world, I think 20% is more realistic, but certainly achievable, which is obviously in the context we're talking about big, big numbers. So what's your thoughts in that space?
I think it's a really good quality two pages, I would say, even if it is two pages. I think it's right, and I wouldn't say this is easy. I mean, and I wouldn't say that this is the sort of thing that you could just do overnight. But it's something I've been wrestling with way, you know, from Christy. And I think, you know, for me, I think the importance of the data and the importance of the information that's provided to actually really trace through outcomes. So how can we genuinely see where money is being spent, and what does it mean for individuals? And actually, something like Social Security is potentially a really good example of a case study about where that could really be changed, because you're not starting off with any kind of fixed positions or any examples that you've had before. So I mean, I think it's challenging to do. I think the more data you could get, the better. I think there also needs to be a realisation, as we say in the report as well, about the point that Mr. Kelly was making around, you know, moving away from fixed positions and points that you make around something. So if you take, for example, things like, you know, protecting the health budget is a good example of where we define that as a portfolio. So we define it as a level 2 budget settlement, and we say, well, we'll protect the health budget. Well, actually, the question should be, or the answer should be, is how do we improve health outcomes? And that could be investing in, you know, programs in social justice. It could be investing in programs in local government. And we need to get much better at linking all of that information in a much better way. As I said, data is crucial to that. There's some good examples of where that's been done before in individual spending lines. And I think the more that we can do on that, the better. And that might be the sort of thing that that the Finance Committee would want to have a look at. And that's definitely something that we'll be looking at quite, you know, strongly over the next few months and years.
Okay, thanks.
Quickly, because I've got two other members who want to come.
Very quickly. It was back to what we were talking about, the fragility of the Scottish economy. If you look back, your chart 2.1, you go back 2 years and look at the growth rate. Scotland and the UK is broadly similar. You look at what you say on historical tax growth, Scotland versus UK, page 43. Scotland's actually the higher tax growth in VAT and income tax over the kind of 14-15 year period. And you also talk in the report somewhere about potential differential Brexit impact, where the rest of the UK could have a higher because of the sectors it's involved in, finance, etc., plus geographically closer, could have a higher Brexit impact than Scotland. So based on all of that, and I suppose that the last part of that was you're comparing UK growth rates to Scotland, which is fine in the context of what it does on BGA, but is a more interesting comparison not other small European countries and their historical growth rates, which have been significantly higher than Scotland?
Thanks for the short question.
Yeah.
You don't want to hear a long question.
Exactly. So I guess there was three parts in that short question. I guess the first thing, yes, you're entirely right. You know, what we're looking at is just the short-term horizon for the Scottish economy, what's happened over the last year. And that's for this budget and this Parliament, that's probably the crucial bit. But you're entirely right that if you actually look over the last, you know, particularly since the start of devolution, actually Scotland's done, you know, relatively better on many indicators than the rest of the UK, the tax revenues being, you know, an example of that. I guess the question is, well, is that likely to continue, you know, going forward? And that's where our concerns about what's been happening over the last year, if that continues in the short term, then that could have an impact on the Scottish budget. And we do compare it deliberately against the UK because that's what matters in this fiscal framework. That's a crucial bit. The way the fiscal framework works is that Scotland's budget will be better off relative to Barnett if Scotland's tax receipts per head grow more quickly than the rest of the UK. Now, you may disagree with that framework and that starting point, but that's the way the framework is going to work. So comparisons with other small countries or comparable countries is an interesting exercise, and there's obviously a lot of issues in there. But from a fiscal framework point of view, then that is almost slightly irrelevant because what really matters is the comparison between Scotland and the rest of the UK. Is relative for potential growth rates in the sense of what you might do with the levers and things like that. But in terms of this comparison, it ultimately comes down to Scotland and the rest of the UK. And so we're predicting next year growth in Scotland of 0.5%. The average forecast at the UK level for next year is about 0.7. So we're predicting slightly slower growth than in the rest of the UK.
Yeah, but taking us a wee bit away from the Chapter 4 issues, which are, and other people wanted to speak, Patrick Harvey, then James Kelly.
Thanks very much.
Sorry to Ash, I've not managed to get you in on Brexit, even though that was raised as part of the question put by Evan. We'll come back to you.
Okay. I suppose I wanted to take some of these arguments that come across in Chapter 4 around outcomes and prevention and so on, and compare that with the approach that you've actually taken in Chapter 3 in looking at the Scottish Government's spending commitments. It seems to me that when you're looking at, for example, the childcare and health spending commitments, it seems to imply simply what is the consequent additional squeeze on unprotected areas and what additional cut will happen as a result of that. Do you, and how do you, take account of the other kinds of saving or other kinds of beneficial impacts of those kinds of spending on the Scottish budget? We know that that kind of social infrastructure can enable people to become more economically active. It can reduce the costs of poverty, which have a financial cost to the Scottish Government as well as a human cost. And even within an overall envelope, it can ensure that some of the worst effects of that burden don't fall on those least able to cope with it. So can I ask how you've taken account of those arguments that you make in Chapter 4 in your methodology in Chapter 3?
I mean, it's a very good point. I mean, what we're doing is essentially saying how we trace through the document is really just to almost come at that same question but from the other way around, which is to say if you go through the mechanistic approach of looking by what happens at portfolios and what happens from the overall budget, then this is what you get and these are the challenges within these unprotected areas and things. I think then we come back to square the circle is actually to come back round to your point and say, well, in this environment, both presentationally but also in terms of delivery of public services, what's the solution to this? And the solution to this is to exactly, you know, do what you're talking about and to actually say, well, actually, how do you focus on outcomes? How do you focus on prevention? So that when you do have consequences of changes within individual portfolio lines, that then has implications, you know, wider implications for demand for public services, etc., in other areas. So that's, I think, what we're trying to do in Chapter 4 is come back round to exactly the point you make. I think the only thing I would say, the cautionary within that is, is twofold. One is, what's the likelihood that you will get these benefits in the short term? So that, I think, is an issue that needs to be borne in mind there. But secondly, are these investments in these certain areas actually going to deliver changes in outcomes that you're looking at? So childcare is probably an example where we know actually that will lead to long-term benefits and improvements in terms of other services and things like that. But you then start to get interesting policies. Well, what do you spend the extra money in health on? You know, what are you actually genuinely going to use that money, as you suggest, to pay in social infrastructure or health infrastructure that then leads to these other benefits? And I guess that's our challenge back, is that how do you actually use the money in the protected areas most effectively to then deliver better outcomes, which then means that demand in unprotected areas might fall, or you might make savings, or you might actually deliver better outcomes.
So the Institute at the moment moment isn't at a point of being able to take some of these spending commitments and make a judgment or an assessment about what the potential positive consequences are yet.
Yeah, though we could do. I mean, that's not what this report does. What this report does, as I said, is simply build up the mechanistic to say, well, this is what you then mean in that. Because within that, it's then you start to get into the interesting questions about, well, what do you spend the money in health on? You know, and that gets into the stuff around prevention. And one of the things that we're really interested in looking at is trying to think about how do you approach the whole concept of inclusive growth within a framework such as this. The way you traditionally do it in economics can't let you capture the whole benefits of inclusive growth and elements and how you develop that. And that, I think, is a really interesting bit to look at. And I think that's probably the next part of this exercise. Because I think you're right, how you then look at the spending underneath these high-level bits becomes really crucial. And how do you inform that actually, okay, if the health budget is rising by £500 million, how do you best use that in a way which benefits outcomes across the board?
I suspect, Convener, this only underlines the argument for Parliament to have enough time to take ample evidence, a wide range of evidence, when we do have a draft budget published.
James.
Thank you, Convener. Just going back to the section on transparency, you make what some might feel is a minor point, but I actually think is quite an important point about the presentation of the budget, and that when the documents are released into the public domain, they come in PDF format as opposed to Excel. And I suspect you spoke at the start of the session about how you've built up your team in recent months and you've got a good number of experts. But in order for yourself and other stakeholders to best and quickly analyse the budget, particularly if we are going to be looking at it in a curtailed timetable, do you think that the Scottish Government should consider publishing it in Excel as a matter of priority?
I think that would be a helpful step. And as I said, I think if you look at, for example, what the OBR do, as I was using that as an example, they essentially publish all of their Excel, you know, data, they publish every chart, every table that they produce. They publish that information, you know, in a transparent way, and it's a very simple thing, but actually helps, you know, it helps very quick analysis and quick scrutiny of what's going on. I mean, the wider point we make about transparency, I think, is that actually this framework that we're now going to get is exceptionally complex. There's going to be, you know, challenges between forecasts, revisions, money moving from reserves into, you know, budget outturns, forecasts for the BGA, forecasts for the Scottish tax revenues, reconciliations, borrowing for cash flow. It's going to be exceptionally complex. And I think the only way that you'll get effective scrutiny, but actually crucially the only way you'll get trust in the system, is by having all of that, you know, transparently set out. So you know why a budget is falling 3 years from now. It's because there was a forecast error 4 years ago. Well, you know, you need to be able to have information to do that so people will trust it. If you thought Barnett was difficult and all the complexities with Barnett, well, you ain't seen nothing yet.
Ash Denham.
Thanks. Good morning. The Institute have modelled the potential effects of Brexit on the Scottish economy. And you've sort of summarised that by saying you think it'll have significant negative effect on the economy, and that GDP over the next decade will be between 2 and 5% lower as a result. So I was wondering if you could expand a little bit on that, but I assume that that takes into account an expected reduction in international investment into the Scottish economy. Because obviously we know Scotland had been doing quite well on that, and it was the sort of second biggest location outside of, I think it was London in the southeast. The other thing is obviously if FDI is considered to be a driver for things like productivity and innovation in the Scottish economy, should we be concerned if that's lower, that obviously the productivity in the economy will be lower as a result of that as well because of a Brexit consequences?
Okay, I mean, I guess, so in this context, I guess there's a couple of points that are quite important to bear in mind. So what our modelling does is essentially look at what might be the shock from Brexit having an impact on both the Scottish and the UK economies over the long term. Now, there's obviously quite a debate about the scale of that shock, whether it's positive, you know, negative. Most economists would you know believe that it will have a negative impact in the long run because it might have implications for trade and so forth. So using that as a starting point, then you'll have a as we say in the report, as a slightly negative impact on Scottish GDP of between 2 and 5%, lower than it otherwise would have been. Couple of things within that as well, as you rightly point out, what are the potential implications for investment? We know that Scotland's done relatively well in recent years in international investment. If that's impacted in some way by Brexit, then that would have potentially a disproportionate impact on Scotland relative to the rest of the UK, and that would be a concern if it was to feed through to productivity and so forth. But on the other hand, I think it's also important to note as well that this all assumes that policy remains constant, so we don't know what may happen in the future in a post-Brexit world. So there's, policy might change, trade deals might be arranged, et cetera, and that would change the growth trajectory there. The other thing, what's really crucial in the context of the fiscal framework, is the relative impact of Scotland and, relative to the rest of the UK. Because what is really crucial is what happens, as explained, is the growth in UK tax revenues relative to the Scottish tax revenues. And if we can grow more quickly or fall less slowly, then we would be better off relative to where we were in Barnett. And actually what's quite interesting from the research that we've done is that we find that actually the negative impact on Scotland and the rest of the UK is actually slightly, potentially, on our modelling, slightly less in Scotland than the rest of the UK. Because the UK has slightly more trade integration with the rest of the EU. So, interesting, if you just take that for what it is, then it might mean that in the medium to long term, that the fiscal framework might actually, the way it would work, is that Scotland might be less impacted than it would be than before. So, there's quite a lot of complex issues going on in there. But the basic point, I guess, is that Brexit will have a negative impact on the Scotland and UK economy. What's crucial for the fiscal framework is whether it's more or less impacted than in Scotland and the rest of the UK. There's some areas such as investment and productivity that could be a concern that might make it worse. But in our modelling, we actually show that actually at the moment, our estimate is it might be slightly less in Scotland than it is would be in the rest of the UK.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Ash. Murdo.
Yes, thank you, Convener. One question that's not been touched on so far is in relation to the Scottish Government's capital spend. And there's a comment you make on page 68 in relation to the Scottish Government having new borrowing powers for capital spend in 2015-16 of up to 10% of the capital DEL budget, which would be around £300 million. So far, the Scottish Government has not utilised that capital borrowing. Would you expect that to be used by the end of the year, or is there any indication that, the Scottish Government are perhaps struggling to find projects to spend this money on?
I wouldn't know on that. I mean, I think the one thing I would say about the use of borrowing powers, my assumption would be is that you'd expect to see that kick in and be used toward the end of the financial year, because you might as well use all your capital DEL first. So I would expect that you might see a trend for any administration that actually what they would do is tend to use capital DEL in the first part of the year and then unlock the capital borrowing powers toward the end of the financial year. So I'd say from an accounting perspective, that's probably what I'd expect to see. Whether there's an issue with capital projects, and so I wouldn't know.
I said at the beginning I'd like to have a question myself about structural slowdown issues, particularly as it plays against the fiscal framework. And your report highlights the risk to Scotland's economic performance should the recent North Sea oil slowdown prove to be part of a more sustained picture. It describes the lack of fiscal support mechanisms to counteract an asymmetrical structural decline in a sector in which Scotland is more heavily concentrated as a weakness embedded within the new fiscal framework, and notes that there are no new mechanisms to protect devolved services during sustained structural slowdown, which is pretty worrying. As a result, you conclude that Scotland's budget is now much more exposed to the risks that the Scottish Government has limited ability to mitigate. In your view, what would be necessary to increase the Scottish Government's ability to mitigate against these structural issues?
Yeah, so just to be clear, what we're saying there is that under the fiscal framework, if you have a cyclical asymmetric shock, so something that's purely temporary, then Scottish Government now has revenue borrowing powers to do that. So if you have a shock where Scottish GDP is less than 1% and more than 1% away from the rest of the UK, you can unlock these asymmetric borrowing powers. The point we're trying to make there is actually one, well, what happens if you have a long-term shock? So you have a sector which is not going through a cyclical change, but is actually going through a structural change, and Scotland is disproportionately more invested in that than the rest of the UK. What mechanisms are in the fiscal framework to deal with that? There isn't anything, you know, directly in there in the fiscal framework to do it. You still have, on the reserve side of things, the insurance mechanism that, if you take North Sea revenues that they are collected at the UK level, unemployment benefits, etc., still, you know, from a UK level. So you have a mechanism there that helps smooth the structural adjustment. But purely in terms of devolved services, if you have a decline in a sector which is reducing your income tax revenues, reducing your employment, reducing earnings, etc., then there is no mechanism, automatic mechanism, to deal with that. So I think that's the sort of thing I think would be a challenge for going forward. You can then argue that the Scottish Government could potentially be using its new powers in a more effective way, so using its capital borrowing or using its tax levers, etc. But it's something which I would say that is there, that actually isn't there, you know, isn't in the fiscal framework that you can immediately provide a response to. So if you want to actually make an adjustment, you have to change devolved services, or you have to change taxation, or you have to change borrowing. But there isn't an additional mechanism like this cyclical mechanism that exists in the fiscal framework to deal with a situation like this.
Is that something that's happened, a long-term structural issue across the UK? What mechanisms would the UK have to deal with that sort of impact?
Well, so I guess there's two things. One is that they could obviously use greater borrowing powers over a period of time. Secondly, the way that it would work with this fiscal framework is that if the UK was having a structural challenge, then it would be UK revenues as a whole that would be declining, which would in turn mean that the block grant adjustment would be declining as well. So if it was a shared shock, so if this was a shock which was identical in Scotland and the rest of the UK, then Scottish tax revenues would fall, yes, but also the block grant adjustment would fall. So the net effect would be zero. The challenge we have here is that Scottish tax revenues are being suppressed by the shock, but the block grant adjustment is not being affected by it because the UK is a much smaller fraction of the UK economy.
Is your institute looking at that more deeply, at that particular issue, or are there other institutes out there who are doing that sort of work? Because that's obviously something in the longer term is going to be quite an important issue.
Yeah, so it's something that we are looking at. I mean, we're one of the things that we're doing is developing our economic modelling that we have in the Fraser Islander. So the models that looked at the Brexit shock and things like that. We're now extending them to build in the fiscal framework into these models, so we can look at what happens if you have an asymmetric structural shock between Scotland and the rest of the UK. What would be the potential long-term economic implications of that? But also then, what are the opportunities around if you can grow your economy more quickly? What are the long-term benefits of being able to recycle these revenues over and over again into public services and into the wider economy?
Patrick?
Just very briefly on that, I assume from what you're saying that if, for example, a hard Brexit scenario resulted in a similar shock to financial services, that clearly would have some effect in Scotland, but it would have a much bigger effect in the rest of the UK. Mm-hmm. So that kind of asymmetric shock in the other direction would have a positive effect in Scotland. Is that a correct assumption?
Exactly, yeah, and that's the asymmetry that's in it. So in that scenario, what you would have is the block grant adjustment being much smaller than it would have been, and Scottish tax revenues being less impacted by that. So you would have an asymmetric shock in the other direction. So I guess that's the key point, is that there's this asymmetry built into the potential system where you take on. Scottish Government is now facing additional risks, both up and downside, which you actually don't control. You actually don't have the lever to control or address.
Thank you.
an area I'm sure at some stage in the future we'll need to come back and look at a bit more, examine it, but obviously we don't have time to go into that level of detail today. On the issue of transparency issues and the amount of information that's available, I just wondered what level of macroeconomic data should be the Scottish Government be prioritising, what we should be expect to be seeing published, you know, economic growth data, etc. What do you think would help us in that area?
So I think there's a number of things. I think on the economy side of things, I think what you really want to scrutinise and look at are what are the assumptions that underpin the modelling. Models are models, and they'll give you a number. But what's crucial is what you put into these models. And I think that's one of the things the OBR have done really well, is that they just set out all the various assumptions about how they come up with the results. I think that's crucial, because I think that then you then know why you're maybe expecting Scottish growth to go be more, you know, faster or slower. You can actually trace what are the effects within there. So I think there's a lot you could do on the information that, say, for example, the OBR produce on the economic side that would be useful to have. What are the determinants of future stamp duty revenues going forward? What are the key determinants? What are assumptions about that? And then, are these assumptions reasonable? That then means that you can scrutinise it. So if you see that revenues are growing quickly, you know why they're growing quickly, because it's assumptions about faster house price growth or faster or greater increase in the number of houses. So I think that sort of information would be really quite crucial. I think the second bit is actually what information you'd want on the fiscal side of things. So we touched on this already around information within budget lines, non-cash versus cash, so you can actually see where the discretion is, issues around bits of the budget that are committed going forward. So, for example, the obvious thing in there is, you know, NPD and PPP commitments. You know these are locked in. So within budgets, how much of a budget are they going to, how much of the share of a budget within a portfolio are they going to take? Is it, you know, did they take a large share within the education portfolio, or did they take a small share within the education portfolio? And then that lets you scrutinise and be a bit more aware about what the opportunities are to do something different and how constrained you are. So I think thinking about both the economic side, but also the fiscal and the budget side would be quite useful.
I don't see MD indicating they want to come in with any other supplementary. So can I thank Professor Graeme Roy for, you know, his fascinating and illuminating session. Actually, I think I certainly found it very interesting. The next meeting of the committee will take place on the 28th of September, when the committee will take evidence as part of its inquiry into the first year's operation of the Land and Buildings Taxation Tax. At the start of the meeting, we said we'd take the next item in private. I therefore now close this public part of the meeting and we'll take a short break. Thank you.